Now, I'm starting off today's list with the first person that came to my mind, the great Rasputin. Close family friend of the last royal Russian family, he was originally introduced to them as a faith healer who could aid their only son, Alexei, who suffered from hemophilia. A self-described mystic and holy man, Rasputin was a figure of much debate amongst the royal court, with some describing him as a visionary and prophet, others as a charlatan and scam artist. Historians believe that his scandalous reputation and influence over the Romanovs only helped to discredit and overthrow the family. Having taken many pilgrimages to holy monasteries, he developed a reputation as a revered holy man, gaining a small circle of followers who believed in his miracles, and began leading private prayer meetings, much to the scorn and suspicion of villagers and priests. It was rumored that female followers were ceremonially washing him before each meeting, that the group sang strange songs, and even that they had joined a religious sect whose rituals were rumored to include self-flagellation and orgies. Word of Rasputin's activity and charisma began to spread in Siberia during the early 1900s, where he developed many friendships with high-ranking religious leaders, eventually leading to his introduction to the royal family. It's not certain when Rasputin first acted as Alexei's healer, with the earliest record on date being when he was summoned by Alexandra to pray for Alexei when he had an internal hemorrhage in the spring of 1907, with the young royal healing by the next morning. Due to his closeness with the family, Rasputin was allowed intimate access to the family in situations that governesses to the young royals described as inappropriate. One governess in particular was released from her position simply for voicing her concerns about Rasputin being allowed around the young ones while they were clad in nothing but their nightgowns. Another one of the nursery governesses claimed in the spring of 1910 that she was seduced into sexual acts against her will by Rasputin, originally having been a devotee of the man, but was later disillusioned by him. The Empress refused to believe her and said that everything Rasputin does is holy, later dismissing the governess. It was whispered in society that Rasputin had seduced not only the Tsarina, but also the four young Grand Duchesses. Rasputin had released passionate letters written to him by the Tsarina and the four Grand Duchesses throughout society. In 1916, a group of nobles led by Prince Felix Yusupov banded together, deciding to assassinate the holy man for his influence over the Tsarina and her family. It is said that the prince invited Rasputin to his place shortly after midnight, where he offered the man tea and cakes which had been laced with cyanide. Rasputin initially said no, but then began to eat the cakes, and to Felix's surprise, appeared unaffected by the poison. Then he asked for wine, which had also obviously been poisoned, drank three glasses, and still showed no signs of distress. So around 2:30 in the morning, Felix excused himself to go upstairs, where his fellow conspirators were waiting, and he grabbed a revolver and returned to the basement, telling Rasputin that he'd better look at the crucifix and say a prayer, referring to a crucifix in the room, then, you know, nailed him once in the chest. Rasputin leapt up from the explosive and attacked Felix, who freed himself with some effort and fled upstairs. Rasputin followed Felix, where he was once again impaled with an explosive, and he collapsed into a snowbank. The group of men that wrapped his body in cloth drove it to the Petrovsky Bridge, and then, you know, they all dropped it in the Malaya Nevka River. If you missed something there, it took a combination of cyanide, multiple rounds of explosives, and drowning before Rasputin met the end of time. There's no way that wasn't witchcraft. Okay, we're gonna move on before I see his face in my nightmares tonight. I already had one last night, I don't need more. So when it comes to history, some folks stand out for being a hero. Great virtue. Nobody today, though. They're all going to stand out for their descent into darkness. Mary Bateman, a woman born in Asenbury, Yorkshire in 1768, was kind of that sort of person. Her life, detailed in The Extraordinary Life and Character of Mary Bateman, fitting title, reads like a macabre tale of deceit, poison, and a chilling transformation from a seemingly ordinary existence to a practitioner of dark arts. Raised on a farm, Mary transitioned from a farm girl to a servant in Thirsk when she reached her teens. Her life took an ominous turn when she was 20, and she moved to York and worked as a dressmaker. A year later, she found herself entangled in a burglary and subsequently fled to Leeds. Over the following years, Mary's occupation shifted from mantua maker to fortune teller and wise woman, gradually building her reputation in the shadows. In 1792, she married John Bateman, but her criminal inclinations persisted. Robberies, prison escapes, even accusations of working as an abortionist marked her darker exploits. Her criminal activities continued even after her marriage, as she roamed the streets of Leeds, posing as a charitable soul, collecting goods for fire victims, only to keep the gifts for herself. In a peculiar twist, Mary joined the followers of the prophetess Joanna Southcott in 1806. She orchestrated the infamous Prophet Hen of Leeds hoax, claiming that eggs laid by a hen bore apocalyptic messages. A penny was the price of admission to witness these so-called prophetic eggs. However, the truth behind the spectacle revealed Mary's deceitful hand. She had written on the eggs using ink, and cunningly reinserted them into the hen. The year 1806 marked another dark chapter in Mary's life when she was approached by William and Rebecca Perigo. Claiming Rebecca was under a spell, Mary began feeding them poison pudding, leading to Rebecca's demise in 1808. William accused Mary of both poisoning his wife and defrauding them for charms and cures. Mary's trial in York in March of 1809 painted a picture of a cunning and malevolent woman. The jury swiftly found her guilty of fraud and Rebecca's, well, death. Facing execution, Mary attempted to evade, you know, rope necklace by declaring pregnancy. A panel of matrons assessed her claim, but the jury of women found it false. So on March 20th, Mary met her end at the gallows alongside a couple of men. Oh, but her story does not end here. I wish it did. The after-death fate of Mary Bateman took a gruesome turn, so after her execution, her body was displayed at Leeds General Infirmary, charging visitors for the macabre spectacle. Dissected by William Hay, her remains became a commodity. Strips of her skin were turned into charms, and the tip of her tongue became a morbid keepsake. No thanks.
Number 3. Ted Bundy. Ted Bundy has fascinated people for years, due in large part to how well he was able to disguise himself and make himself appear normal. But underneath his carefully put together persona was one of the darkest, most truly vile criminals the United States had ever seen. Unlike most serial offenders, Bundy not only kept up appearances, but was well-groomed, charming, charismatic, and had a very compelling way with words, able to manipulate people scarily efficiently. He came from a happy family, a good Christian household, and didn't seem to fit the usual bill for these sort of criminals. The last interview ever conducted with him highlights a lot of these traits. He appears very soft-spoken, speaking quietly and almost soothingly to the camera, doing his best to garner sympathy from the audience and the interviewer. He attempts to blame a lot of his violence, darkness, and misdeeds on an addiction to lewd content. When he's describing it, he almost sounds like a man trying to talk about kicking caffeine, saying, "Oh, I think I'd be a lot better without it." Not just for him, but for lots of other people. When he says that phrase, he pauses a bit and gives a dark, knowing look to the interviewer. He's even joking around a bit, playfully. He comes across as very intelligent, answering all of the questions thoughtfully, but everything about it just seems terrifying, especially knowing the grisly nature of the things he did, but it feels like you're listening to a mask talk. It helps you understand how he was able to commit so much of what he did the way you hear him talk. When asked directly if he thinks he deserves his punishment, he answers eloquently, saying he's afraid to die, but he feels that he deserves to be punished to the most extreme extent of the law, and that society will be better off without dangers like him. It is a frigid look into the mind of someone so twisted. Number 2. Dahmer. Jeffrey Dahmer is infamous. The name immediately evokes horrible emotions. Perhaps you've seen one of the many movies based on his twisted crimes, but the truth is always scarier. In 1994, Jeffrey Dahmer would give his last interview before his final sentencing, speaking to Stone Phillips, a former NBC anchor. The interview featured his father Lionel present, who Dahmer did not share a close relationship with. Now, the entire extended segment is harrowing. Dahmer is completely cold and calculating the entire time, speaking dryly with almost no emotion to anything he's saying. It's as fascinating as it is horrifying to hear him talk, to be honest. He remembers everything very clearly, and he describes it plainly, matter-of-fact, extremely sterilely. But there is a hint of remorse, almost regret over what he's done, but it is impossible to tell truly if it's genuine sincerity, or if it's all just a carefully manipulated act to appear sympathetic. Perhaps the most disturbing insight into Dahmer's brain is when he tells the reporter that he found the violent acts of his crimes distasteful, and said that it was all just a means to an end of his ultimate goal, which was having complete physical domination over someone else. He describes his crimes as not something I enjoyed doing, and then proceeds to explain his sinister desire to create living zombies by putting acid in brains, leaving people docile and helpless. Dahmer was known as well to keep trophies of his victims, calling into question if any of these statements rang true. He reiterates that he just wanted someone to keep under his complete control, a slave to his will. And number 1. Charles Manson. Charles Manson may very well be the most notoriously well-known criminal in American history. He's definitely the most well-known cult leader. The cult leader led a string of violent attacks in 1969 to 1971 that would eventually culminate in his arrest and standing trial for his grievous crimes. Manson would spend the rest of his life in jail and occasionally entertained interviewers looking to shed light on the bizarre, grisly story. Manson was charismatic in his own way, persuasive, outrageous, and most importantly, commanding. demanding and controlling. But if you ever saw any of his interviews after his arrest, you'd be forgiven for not thinking that, since pretty much every time he opens his mouth, it's either to share his bleak, nihilistic worldview, or raving in a way that is just completely incomprehensible and is the gibbering of a madman. As soon as this one interview starts, he boasts that he doesn't feel guilty since he hasn't done anything he's ashamed of, and then pausing for a second and clarifying, "I'm ashamed of not doing enough." From there, he then starts speaking complete gibberish, and then elaborating a bit on some of the conditions that made him this way. He talks about growing up without parents, which left him feeling like he was in a different dimension, saying that it's hard for him to think about things clearly, saying he hardly remembers breakfast. Watching Manson talk is a fascinating study. He almost seems fictional, a larger-than-life personality ripped out of a comic book villain, but he's real. And the real darkness behind his eyes is a harrowing reminder of what can lie inside someone. Most of the interviews with Manson are like this. Ravings, rantings, a stream of vile hatred and aggression, and a peek into the minds of one of the most twisted men to ever live.
Number 5. Gertrude Banaszewski. Gertrude Banaszewski, a name etched in infamy, became the orchestrator of one of the most gruesome and heart-wrenching crimes in American history. Born in 1929, she seemed like an ordinary woman, but beneath the facade lurked a malevolence that would shock the nation. Gertrude's path to darkness intersected with the life of Sylvia Likens, a young girl entrusted to her care. The Likens family, facing personal struggles, sought assistance from Gertrude, believing her to be a pillar of support. Little did they know, this decision would prove catastrophic and fatal for Sylvia. What unfolded within the walls of Gertrude's home was a systematic and sadistic campaign of injury and cruelty against Sylvia Likens. The cruelty inflicted upon the innocent girl was beyond comprehension. Gertrude, fueled by a toxic combination of jealousy, anger, and a perverse desire for control, subjected Sylvia to unimaginable, unforgivable torment. Gertrude's cruelty extended beyond physical injuries. She engaged in a twisted form of psychological warfare. Manipulating Sylvia's emotions, Gertrude carefully molded an atmosphere of fear and despair. The torment inflicted was not merely physical, but a calculated attack on Sylvia's mental state. Gertrude's malevolence was amplified by the complicity of her own offspring and neighborhood youths. They became willing participants in the heinous acts, contributing to the atmosphere of terror that surrounded Sylvia Likens. Gertrude's ability to influence others to join in on her atrocities is a display of the chilling charisma that dwelled within her malevolent nature. The revelation of Gertrude Banaszewski's crimes sent shockwaves through the community and the nation. The public, repulsed by the unspeakable acts committed against Sylvia, expressed their collective outrage. Gertrude's actions transcended the boundaries of human decency, earning her the disdain of society at large. Justice, though delayed and brought far too late, eventually caught up with Gertrude Banaszewski. The legal system, tasked with holding perpetrators accountable, recognized the gravity of her crime. Gertrude faced the consequences of her actions in a court of law, where the enormity of her deeds was laid bare for all to witness. Gertrude Banaszewski's name has become synonymous with evil. Her crimes against Sylvia Likens serve as a reminder of the capacity for darkness that can reside within seemingly ordinary individuals and seemingly ordinary families and neighborhoods even. The legacy of infamy she left behind continues to haunt the collective conscience, a true testament to the depths of human depravity. Number 4. Leopold II of Belgium. Leopold II of Belgium, who reigned from 1865 to 1909, is remembered not for his nation-building efforts, but for the atrocities committed during his brutal exploitation of the Congo Free State. This dark chapter in history has left a reddened stain on Leopold's legacy, leading him to be widely viewed as an evil figure, despised by the collective public. Leopold's insatiable greed drove him to exploit the Congo Free State for its large array of rubber and ivory resources. Under the guise of humanitarian and philanthropic endeavors, he embarked on a ruthless mission that subjected the indigenous population to forced labor, physical harm, and systemic cruelty. The rubber trade in particular witnessed horrifying events, as the Congolese people endured unimaginable suffering to meet the never-ending demands of the European market. Leopold's agents, tasked with maximizing profits, employed horrific methods to enforce rubber quotas. The Congolese people were subjected to forced labor, with villages facing severe consequences if they failed to meet the imposed quotas. The horrors extended to widespread mutilations, where hands were amputated as a grim means of punishment and control. The reign of terror aimed to instill fear and compliance among the exploited population. The relentless exploitation and unimaginable conditions led to an alarming death toll in the Congo Free State. state. Countless lives were lost due to disease, malnutrition, and the direct consequences of Leopold's merciless rule. The human cost of his economic ambitions was staggering, leaving a trail of devastation that scarred the region for generations. As news of the atrocities in Congo emerged, an international outcry against Leopold's actions gained momentum. Humanitarian organizations, investigative journalists, and prominent figures denounced the inhumane practices and called for an end to the atrocities. Leopold's reputation, tarnished on the global stage, prompted widespread condemnation. Leopold II's legacy is now one of infamy and hatred. Despite his attempts to portray himself as a benevolent, fair, and justified leader, the atrocities committed under his rule have left a mark on history, forever tying him to his heinous actions.
Number 3 on this list is Idi Amin. Idi Amin was a horrible individual who was brutal in every sense of the word. He overthrew the government in Uganda in 1971 and was in power there until 1979, when he was finally ousted. During his time in power, he showed the world just how horrifically evil he was. History.com says, once in power, Amin began mass executions upon the Akoli and Lango Christian tribes that had been loyal to Obote and therefore perceived as a threat. He also began terrorizing the general public through the various internal security forces he organized, such as the State Research Bureau and Public Safety Unity, whose main purpose was to eliminate those who opposed his regime. In 1972, Amin expelled Uganda's Asian population, which numbered between 50 and 70,000, resulting in a collapse of the economy as manufacturing, agriculture, and commerce came to a screeching halt without the appropriate resources to support them. Throughout his oppressive rule, Amin was estimated to have been responsible for the deaths of roughly 300,000 civilians. One of the worst parts about all of this is that he never had to pay for these heinous acts. After he was ousted in 1979, he fled to Saudi Arabia and just lived out the rest of his life there under protection. He lived comfortably there after having caused so much pain and death just years prior. He lived like this for decades until he finally died in 2003 from natural causes. Idi Amin doesn't get nearly as much media coverage as he should. The atrocities that took place in Uganda during the 70s need to be talked about more and must be acknowledged. Millions of people during that time would have been living in total fear of this man. I think it's fair to assume he probably still haunts the dreams of those who had to live through this terrible trauma. Number 2 on this list is Joseph Stalin. Stalin is another one of those guys who just has to be on this list. His name is synonymous with evil and hatred and death. Next Luxury says, much like Hitler, Joseph Stalin was loved by his supporters and hated by everyone else. The dictator governed the Soviet Union from 1922 until his death in 1953. His communist identity was influenced by Marxism-Leninism, resulting in his own idea known as Stalinism. Throughout his rule, millions died, particularly during the famine of 1932 and 1933, thanks to his disruption of the economy. Stalin was also responsible for the Great Purge, where a further 1 million were imprisoned and around 700,000 executed. To this day, Stalin supporters revere him as a champion of the working class, looking past the ethnic cleansing and mass executions that happened during his time in power. Stalin's horrifying exploits are often overlooked because just a little further down the line, you do have the whole Adolf Hitler thing. Stalin was right up there though as being just as brutal. The way he treated the Ukrainian people was absolutely horrific. He starved them for the sake of starving them. We cannot have another one of these individuals in our world ever again. We barely made it out the first time that we had one. Number 5 on this list is Thomas de Torquemada. This is a name that is often forgotten. Thomas isn't often talked about in the same conversations as some of the other people on this list. He didn't kill as many people as some of the other people here, but don't think for a second he wasn't as evil. Had he the means to do so, he assuredly would have killed far more people than he did, and he still killed a ton. Next Luxury writes, the first Grand Inquisitor, Thomas de Torquemada, was a religious zealot. Like many in Spain during the 14th century, he believed Catholicism was the one true religion, and anyone who disagreed had to be punished. The Spanish Inquisition was established to help combat heresy, but actually helped solidify those in power who ruled through fear and violence. De Torquemada was one of the nastiest members of the Spanish Inquisition who used brutal torture methods to get confessions from prisoners. He was also responsible for burning thousands of non-believers at the stake.
It wasn't even enough for you to convert to Catholicism. This guy would still come after you even if you did. If he thought you converted because of fear or some other reason he deemed unfit, then he'd force you to wear certain garments and torture you. Heretics would get waterboarded and then often killed afterwards. He saw to the expulsion of over 40,000 Jews from Spain as well. He kicked them out, only allowing them to leave with what they could carry, having to abandon their homes and their livelihoods. On top of this, he killed thousands of people too. This guy was absolutely messed up and would do anything in his power to keep Catholicism alive in Spain. I guarantee that if you lived in Spain during the 1500s, then this guy would definitely have been haunting your dreams. Number 4 on this list is Osama bin Laden. I think we all know this name, and I wouldn't be shocked if some of you have already been haunted in your dreams by it. Next Luxury writes, unlike many of the other evil people on this list, Osama bin Laden wasn't responsible for the deaths of millions. He was officially held accountable for the deaths of 2,977 people. What makes him such a detestable individual was that the murders came about as a result of the September 11th attacks. This remains the deadliest terrorist attack in human history. The legend of the terrorist organization Al-Qaeda, Osama bin Laden was behind the planning of the horrendous attack on American soil. It took 10 years for the American government to find him, finally discovering him hiding out in a compound in Pakistan. An assault on the home was undertaken and bin Laden was shot on sight, ending one of the longest manhunts and bringing some closure to those impacted by the September 11th attacks. This is the biggest terrorist attack in history that we are talking about here, guys. One that shook America and the entire world when it happened. I would have been too young to remember it at the time, but most people you talk to can remember where they were and what they were doing when they heard the news that this happened. I can't imagine having that much hate inside yourself to want to do that to so many innocent people. But that was what Osama bin Laden had. He was filled with hate. He ruined the lives of so many people, and for that reason, he has to make this list.
Next up, we have Walpurgna Hosmanin. So her life at first glance was kind of unremarkable. Born in Bavaria between 1510 and 1527, she spent her days as a midwife, aiding her community. But of course, she couldn't be good, or else she wouldn't be here. Story took a dark turn in 1587 when she became one of the subjects of a ruthless witch trial in Germany. Now, the charges against her were nothing short of horrifying. Witchcraft, sorcery, even vampirism. Under punishment, she confessed to a bizarre tale involving a demon named Federlin, who appeared to her in the guise of a male co-worker. She claimed this demon led her to pledge allegiance to the devil, promising to free her from poverty. As she recounted in her confession, she'd indulged in macabre rituals with Federlin and the devil himself, consuming the roasted flesh of young humans and drinking wine. She described frequent visits to the devil and her demon lover, often engaging in sexual encounters. Eh, you do what you do. Remarkably, she had the power to make her demon lover leave by simply invoking the name of Jesus. Hey, if it works, it works. Now, her confession also included acts of harm using a magical ointment that she had received from her demon lover. This ointment was used to end the lives of many, including the young and animals. Her list of alleged victims was extensive, including 41 young humans, 2 laboring mothers, and a variety of animals. The swift and unanimous decision of the authorities led to her conviction and a gruesome sentence. Before her execution by burning, she endured multiple branding ceremonies, and her right hand, the very hand she had used as a midwife, was severed. Finally, she met her end at the stake, and her ashes were discarded into a street. Goodbye. Off you go. Time to travel over to Paris, France, where we meet La Voisin, also known as Catherine de Chaise. Not a lot is known about her early life. She learned fortune-telling when she was young and later married Antoine Monvoisin, who was active as a jeweler and silk merchant with a shop at Pont-Marie in Paris. When her husband's trade business led to bankruptcy, La Voisin supported the family by practicing chiromancy and face reading. In addition to being a fortune-teller, she was also active as a midwife, which developed into providing abortions. Her business as a fortune-teller gradually developed into manufacturing and selling purported magical objects and potions, also arranging black masses and selling aphrodisiacs and poison to profit from her clients' wishes upon their future. She supported a family of 6, though, including her husband, her mother, and her offspring. She was known to have at least 6 lovers: the executioner André Guillaume, Monsieur Latour, Vicomte de Couserans, the Comte de la Patrie, the alchemist Blessis, the architect Fauché, and the magician Adam Lesage. She was, once again, a French fortune teller, commissioned poisoner, she's gonna emphasize that, and a professional provider of alleged sorcery. She was the head of a network in Paris of witches. So that's how she provided all those poisons, aphrodisiacs, magical services, black masses. She had like a whole network going for her. Her organization of commissioned black magic and poison killings was suspected to have killed over 1,000 people. But it's actually believed that around 2,500 people might have met their ends because of her. Yikes. Oh, and by the way, she was a central figure in the famous Affaire de Poison, in case you didn't know. And because I'm in a fun mood today, let's end this with another male wit. Folks really don't like to talk about that in textbooks, but they did exist. So Gilles Garnier was a reclusive loner living in the woods around Dole, France. Despite being a solitary man, he did marry in 1572. Now historians have reported that Gilles was ill-equipped to provide for his family because he wasn't a really good hunter, since he only really was known to hunt for himself. So that's when he started hunting something else. Anybody wanna guess what? Come on. Yeah, human flesh. The first hunt happened around September 29th of 1572 when Garnier killed a young female, allegedly well in the form of a wolf, and brought some of the flesh home for his wife to eat. How thoughtful. Throughout the autumn, more young humans were found, unalived and mutilated, including another young woman that Garnier bit and clawed at, but was interrupted by passerbys before fleeing. Sadly, the girl succumbed to her injuries a few days later. Now in November, Garnier ended the life of a young man this time, enjoying the flesh from his thighs and belly before tearing off a leg to save for later. I could name more, but I'm feeling a little queasy as it is. Now this caused a stir amongst the townspeople, who believed that it was a werewolf who was committing the horrors. Many folks had witnessed a humanoid-looking wolf near the scenes of the crimes, with the animal darting off once it was aware of being seen. Then in January of 1573, there was one last death. This time villagers heard a young person screaming and the sounds of a wolf, witnessing the wolf attempt to flee the scene, but changing into the form of Garnier as it did. He was then arrested, put on the rack, and confessed to killing the young and consuming their flesh. At his trial, more than 50 people testified, and he was found guilty of lycanthropy, you know, the ability to turn into an animal, and witchcraft. He and his wife were burned at the stake on January 8th of 1573. A witch and werewolf hybrid? Sounds a little too scary for my liking, unless I'm watching Vampire Diaries, which in that case, Team Damon. Maybe I should do that tonight.
Kicking this list off, we have Frankenstein. Okay, not really the Dr. Frankenstein that we know and love, but the man who Mary Shelley based the novel off of, and around. Well, one of them, at least. Mad scientists are still puzzled by the works of one Johann Conrad Dippel. Dippel was born at Castle Frankenstein in Germany, where he would attend university as a philosopher. He studied theology, philosophy, and alchemy at the University of Gießen, obtaining a master's degree in 1693. In the 1700s, he then turned to hermetic studies and alchemy, and this is where it gets a little mad scientist-y. There are claims that during his experiments at Castle Frankenstein, he practiced alchemy and anatomy at the same time, on both the living and the deceased. Yeah. Creepy. Dippel even said that the rumors were true that he had sold his soul to the devil in exchange for secret knowledge. Yeah, that'll do it. He had a huge reputation surrounding dark sorcery, specifically for his work around the Philosopher's Stone and his claim to fame, the Elixir of Life. He performed experiments with cadavers and attempted to transfer the soul of one to another. Yeah, he was obsessed with this idea of soul transference with barely and freshly dead people. Common experiments among alchemists at the time, though. One night, apparently while he was working with nitroglycerin and the effect on magnetism and electricity, apparently led to the destruction and a huge explosion at Castle Frankenstein. It was this night that he apparently was messing around with lightning, and the answer to all his ailments came to him. Local mythology and lore recounts huge explosions and lightning emitted from the castle that night. I guess this was a pretty infamous night. It seems like it's right out of the book, no? Apparently this was the night he acquired the knowledge behind creating the Elixir of Life, his pride and joy. So what exactly happened that night at Castle Frankenstein? Huge lightning storm, or was this guy opening portals looking for souls? You tell me. Number 4, Electro. Okay, they were definitely onto something back then. Lots of magnets and souls and electricity going on. It's 1803. Giovanni Aldini was an Italian physician and physicist born in Bologna, Italy. He, just like the other Dr. Frankenstein, liked to conduct high amounts of electricity through corpses to see what they could do. Yeah, sinister stuff. But science, you know? They like to do these crazy experiments and then write it down and stuff. Lab coats, you know. I have a weak stomach. I could never have sat through these experiments. Since electricity was relatively new at the time, all these zany ideas from these mad scientists multiplied the more playing around with it. Soon, it became otherworldly. The obsession around electricity, magnets, souls, other realms, they were hypothesizing, leading to some pretty evil stuff. In 1803, the fresh body of a murderer was pulled down from the gallows of Newgate Prison in London and taken to the Royal College of Surgeons for experimenting. There, before an an audience of doctors and physicists, Giovanni attempted to breach realms and return the corpse from beyond the grave.
Okay.
Homemade batteries and magnets was used, which made the deceased muscles contort aggressively, and apparently his eyes even opened, looking around the room. Giovanni then stuck the rod where the sun don't shine, then made the whole body start to move about as if it had come to life. For years, he was the leading scientist in electricity and its effect on the body. Apparently, some claim that Aldini would even experiment on himself, pushing the limits and dialing up the voltage. Dude, this guy's Electro from Spider-Man. In recognition of his merits, the Emperor of Austria made him a Knight of the Iron Crown and died not many years later. And although he was unsuccessful at bringing souls back from the dead using electricity, I'm sure this guy experienced more than he shared. I wonder who has his journal.
Number 3, Vlad the Impaler. Vlad the Impaler was a 15th century ruler, left infamous for his sadistic acts. His reign, characterized by extreme cruelty, has earned him a reputation as one of the most despised figures of all time. Vlad's rule in Wallachia, a region in present-day Romania, is categorized as a reign of terror. He gained notoriety for his unrelenting brutality towards his enemies as well as his own subjects. His preferred method of execution, impalement, became synonymous with his name. Thousands met a gruesome end impaled on long, sharp stakes, a macabre spectacle that struck fear into the hearts of anyone unfortunate enough to cross his path. Vlad's cruelty reached its apex with the infamous Forest of the Impaled. After successfully defending his realm against invading forces, he ordered the impalement of all captured soldiers. The grisly display of impaled bodies served as a deterrent, a horrifying warning to anyone who dared challenge his authority. The forest of skewered victims was a perfect display of Vlad's merciless resolve. Vlad employed a variety of sadistic methods to instill fear, beyond impalement. Reports describe gruesome acts of prolonged harm, including boiling, mutilation, and skinning. His cruelty extended to both political enemies and to those within his own court, as he wielded his power with an iron fist, showing no mercy to anyone perceived even as a minuscule threat. Vlad's capital witnessed some of the most heinous acts of his rule. The citadel, a symbol of his power, became a sight of horror. Tales of impaled bodies lining the approaches to the fortress circulated widely, creating an aura of dread that permeated throughout the region. Vlad the Impaler's legacy is one of unmitigated hatred. His extreme sadism has cast a long shadow over history, leaving a stain that prevails centuries later. While some argue that his methods were a response to the turbulent times in which he lived, the sheer barbarity of his rule has ensured that he remains a despised figure. Number 2, Delphine LaLaurie. Delphine LaLaurie personally carved a gruesome chapter in history during the early 19th century. Her actions have left an irrefutable mark on history, permanently painting her as a figure of malevolence and horror. LaLaurie's residence in New Orleans concealed a macabre reality behind its elegant facade. The mansion, a house of unspeakable horrors, bore witness to the twisted deeds that unfolded within its walls at Delphine's hands. It became the epicenter of one of the most notorious crime scenes in American history. The discovery of LaLaurie's atrocities sent shockwaves through the community. Unearthed secrets revealed a horrifying panorama of extreme forms of prolonged harm and torment inflicted upon forcibly employed individuals who were held captive within her mansion. The depths of her depravity left the entire city in disbelief. The revelation of LaLaurie's sadistic acts provoked a visceral, heart-wrenching reaction from the public. The community, once unaware of the horrors lurking behind closed doors, turned against her with an overwhelming sense of repugnance. The magnitude of her cruelty fueled a collective anger that transcended the societal boundaries. Despite the gravity of her crimes, Delphine LaLaurie managed to escape the clutches of justice. Her ability to evade the consequences of her actions only added to the public's fury, the sense of injustice further intensified by the disdain harbored for her. Delphine LaLaurie's legacy is one stained with the deepest hues of hatred. Her name became synonymous with cruelty and inhumanity, a symbol of the darkest, most twisted corners of the human soul. The atrocities committed within the confines of her mansion continue to cast a long, haunting shadow over her memory, and the memory of those who surrounded her. The infamy surrounding Delphine LaLaurie endures through time. Generations later, her name remains a shocking reminder of the capacity for evil that can reside within even the most affluent and seemingly respectable high-class individuals. Number 1. Ivan the Terrible. Ivan V, also known as Ivan the Terrible, is remembered for a reign of inhumanity and cruelty. Widely regarded as one of the most despotic rulers in history, Ivan's actions have left a legacy of fear and loathing. One of the darkest chapters in Ivan's rule was the mass execution of Novgorod in 1570. In 1570, he unleashed a wave of attacks upon the city, accusing its residents of disloyalty. The barbarism shone out during this episode earned Ivan the moniker Terrible. Thousands perished at his hands, and the city's population was decimated. To consolidate power, Ivan created the Oprichnina, a state within a state where he wielded absolute authority over everyone and everything. This elite force, notorious for its ruthless, merciless tactics, unleashed a reign of terror on any perceived threats to the Tsar's supremacy. The Oprichnina's brutal methods, including prolonged torment and public executions, fueled public hatred towards Ivan. Ivan's reign was remembered by his increasing paranoia and erratic behavior. Suspecting conspiracies at every turn, he completely purged his inner circle, even eliminating those close to him. This atmosphere of fear permeated the court, making allegiance a precarious endeavor. As Ivan's tyrannical rule unfolded, the public witnessed a leader consumed by suspicion and cruelty. Ivan's penchant for lending out his own hands to carry out the depraved acts further solidified his reputation as a tyrant. Stories abound of him physically harming his own son, leading to his death. These instances of domestic harm shocked the populace, completely eroding any sliver of sympathy they may have still harbored for their ruler. His acts left an unforgiving mark on the Russian psyche, shaping the perception of subsequent rulers and leaders. The horrors unleashed during his reign cast a long shadow over Russian history, creating a collective memory that recoils at the mention of his name. Ivan the Terrible stands out as a despotic ruler whose reign was marked by unparalleled depravity. The mass attack of Novgorod and the Oprichnina's reign of terror and the ruler's pervasive paranoia have mixed to etch a legacy of unbridled hatred.
Coming in at number 5, Michael Taylor. It's 1974, Yorkshire, England. Michael Taylor, age 31, father of 5 and husband to Christine Taylor. Michael was a well-mannered and caring father and husband. Michael, like anyone, became depressed from a back injury, left him short on work and seeming a little odd and off. After seeking religious advice and a one-on-one session at a local church, Michael started having outbursts and acting aggressively. Puzzled, he sought one-on-one sessions which turned ugly. After apparently changing form and attacking Marie, a young religious leader helping Taylor and unable to remember anything, Michael and the church agreed that an exorcism was necessary. Father Peter Vincent and Reverend Raymond Smith met at St. Thomas and started. It got so violent, he was tied to the church floor. After hours in the middle of the night, the two had managed to exorcise more than 40 demons out of Michael, in which appeared around them as they exited. Violence continued, leaving only 3 demons remaining for the next day. After returning home from the first session, Michael was found now only hours later, naked, in the middle of the street, covered head to toe in blood. Michael had returned home, to which then his wife and family dog lay dead as the police arrived in the AM. His wife, missing her eyes, tongue, and skin from the front of her skull. The dog, torn limb from limb and spread around the home. He was arrested soon after for the death of his wife. Michael had this to say about his late wife in court, quote, "I am released. I am released. It is done. The evil in her has been destroyed." Yeah, that was definitely a vessel for him. He was acquitted on psychological conditions and jury found that he met his breaking point during the exorcism that night. He was acquitted on insanity and remained in and out of facilities until he passed in 2013. Number 4, David Berkowitz. New York, 1976, and the police were busy on the search for a man shooting couples in the New York area, which had started to become a citywide phenomenon that summer. Brunette women with long hair frantically cut and dyed their hair blonde in fear. The 44 caliber killer was the title the press gave David in his earliest of assaults. After losing his job, David began to experience psychotic episodes and claimed that his neighbor's German Shepherd had begun talking to him and eventually explained to David that he was a demon. He took the name after the pet's owner, Sam. It was this dog who ordered the killings by David and claims that the pet coaxed David into killing. David used this summer to shoot 8 people, resulting in 6 lives and the stabbings of 2 others. Using his 44 caliber bulldog revolver, David sent police on a wild goose chase around New York City with handwritten letters, David mocking the detectives with cryptic messages. Some of them explain who Sam is, and some of them explain what Sam does. Some mock police, saying that they are never going to find or stop him. David was finally arrested just hours before his next planned victim's visit. He applauded police in their ability to stop him, in the back seat of the car, laughing and cheering. Although David pleaded not guilty to insanity and pleaded guilty expressing that he was coaxed by the demon and that it demanded him to kill for hell. He was sentenced to 6 consecutive life sentences with parole after 25 years. During the mid-90s, he amended his confession and claimed that he had been a member of a violent satanic cult that orchestrated the incidents as ritual murder and pleaded guilty to stabbing and attempting to murder others before the shootings had even begun. His letters are public and spine-chilling. Check them out. Real Riddler stuff. Quote, "I am the monster. I am Beelzebub. I am the chubby behemoth. Police, let me haunt you with this. I'll be back. I'll be back. Yours in murder, Mr. Monster." Okay, his violent spree led the legal system to create a new law called Son of Sam's Law, designed to create criminals from financially profiting from the publicity created by their crimes, which, at the time, he was basically a celebrity. He remains in prison to this day. Number 3. No, I'm Spartacus. Actually, much, much more evil than him. Heinrich Müller, born in Munich, Germany, April 1900. After serving as a pilot in World War I, he joined the police in Munich, soon acquiring a reputation as a skilled investigator. As such, he would draw the attention of two nastier men, Heinrich H. and Reinhard H., leaders of the German SS Army. Yeah, I don't even like saying their full names out loud. Just Google them up, you'll know. Müller entered the SS in 1934 and quickly rose through the ranks of the organization as a police official. In 1939, when the Gestapo police force and the other organizations joined the Reich, Müller was made head honcho. Yeah, basically this guy was like next in charge to you know who. He was a pretty scary and powerful guy. Müller was involved in a ton of criminal affairs. He helped plan the Polish attack, he signed the bullet order, he authorized the torture of officers who had conspired to kill other SS soldiers. People knew him and knew of him. He was, unfortunately, infamous and a huge deal. This is the weird part. When the Allies moved in and they arrested him, the man turned out to be another Müller. Okay. In fact, they couldn't find the Heinrich Müller, instead arresting many others of the same name. The head of the Gestapo wanted for crimes against humanity had vanished without even a trace. Gone. Even the CIA were like, okay, where the hell did this guy just go? He was just right here. He apparently vanished in the last days of the war. The Western Secret Services started many investigations over the years, but Müller and the vast majority of the Gestapo secret files were never found. In 2001, the CIA reopened its archives about the SS war criminal and revealed it still knew nothing new or conclusive about the SS Heinrich Müller who had been in charge all those years ago. Where did this guy vanish to? I don't know. Number 2. Us. Sure, I've had my fair share of sibling rivalry. One's better at this, one's better at that. But these siblings took it to a whole other realm. The Han twins. Or as I like to call it, the story of good versus evil. A tale as old as time. Well, not that long ago, actually. During the 90s, this was a huge case plastered on every screen of the attempted murder of Sunny Han by her identical twin sister, Gina Han. Whoa. It's November 6, 1996 in California. It quickly became a jaw-dropping case in the media as the case touched on themes of broken families, sister rivalry, split personas, and of course, parallel universes. The sisters had always had disagreements, but apparently hatred became obsession. Throwing some hands here and there became stalking, and eventually jail time. The older they got, the more things escalated. Gina, after escaping prison, had drummed up the idea to hire 2 teenagers to kidnap her sister. Uh-oh. During the kidnapping, the plan, however, failed, and the 2 men were quickly taken into custody by police. Just before going to Sunny's apartment, they went to buy large garbage bags, duct tape, wine, gloves, pine sol cleaner, and magazines. Yeah. The police were notified and luckily reached them before Sunny's evil plan could commence. And it was a close one. They, including the evil sister, were locked and loaded. Literally. Scary. Yeah, as in she literally dodged a bullet on that one. This is like the Metal Mario version of yourself, isn't it? This is terrifying. Do you even think you could take an evil version of yourself? It's sad that it's family, you know? The jury reached their verdict as to each defendant on November 20th, 1997, and Han was convicted of all charges, which were 1 count of conspiracy to commit murder, 2 counts of burglary, 2 counts of false imprisonment, and 1 count of possession of a weapon. So why did she hate her sister so much? How come she wanted to take over her life and just live 1. This has evil parallel universe written all over it, dude. And number 1, the gods. Peru contains its fair share of ancient megalithic ruins. I'll do it again, sorry. Peru contains its fair share of ancient megalithic ruins. If you're not familiar with the construction of myths behind the Machu Picchu and the Nazca lines, then this next one may make you scratch your head. Some would say those are cute compared to this next rock, I don't know. The door in Hayumarka, some think it's a wall, but most believe it becomes a portal to the beyond. The story of the Gate of the Gods, also known as Door of Hayumarka, begins near the banks of the Titicaca over half a millennium ago. According to Incan legend, the universe began here, and according to researchers, the Incan Empire fell here, somewhere around 1592. Peruvians tell the tale of an Incan priest who barely escaped slaughter from the conquistador forces. His name was Aramu Muru, and he was a powerful high priest who served in the Temple of the Seven Rays. To escape his imminent death at the hands of the Spanish army, Muru fled to Hayumarka with the help of other priests, and using a golden disc key, Muru opened the small door in the face of the rock, apparently venturing into another realm. According to legend, the stone door transformed into a bright tunnel that was lit with an unearthly blue light. Aramu Muru passed through the barrier and entered the void, upon which the door then closed behind him. Spooky. Many people believe that he is now living in the land of the gods. Many still believe he is to return with the knowledge of the other side. I mean, if this guy just like platformed 9 3/4 himself through a perfectly sanded rock face, yeah, I'm gonna say it's ancient aliens. Right away, 100%. This site's also been said to be aligned by 5 other archaeological sites, which together form an imaginary cross with straight lines crossing each other exactly at the point where this plateau and lake are located. That makes it even creepier.
Number 5. Grigori Rasputin. Grigori Rasputin, the mad monk of Russia, was a mystical healer who wandered Russia in the early 20th century. Now, I could do a plot summary of what Rasputin got up to, but honestly, Boney M did a better job than I ever will, so just alt tab out of this video real quick, listen to that song, come on back. Okay. Did you? Well, if you didn't, the quick rundown is that the Black Monk genuinely believed himself to be a holy healer with otherworldly powers, and was appointed a lofty position by Tsarina Alexandra to heal the young prince of his hemophilia. He was rumored to be part of a secret order called Klisti, connected with all sorts of scandalous practices. Now, no official connection was ever made to Rasputin and the sect. Rumors of the man still persisted. He carried an infamous reputation around the country, with stories of his wild debauchery and black magic, stories of wild powers. Did he really have otherworldly powers? Given his infamous nigh-immortality, I am a bit inclined to agree with him. The man simply could not be put down without serious effort. There was a plot to have him enticed by a courtesan and castrated until he caught wind of it. In 1914, he was in the chest by a beggar and shrugged it off like it was nothing. Now, of course, the most famous story of Rasputin was his assassination at the hands of the Tsar's cousin and a handful of noblemen. As the famous legend goes, he was poisoned, bludgeoned, and drowned, and still that wasn't enough until he passed later in the day. Was Rasputin just Russia's toughest customer, built different? Or did he have some sort of mystical help from another world? We may never know. And are we having fun with the channel, my little freaks and creeps? Stay subscribed for more scary content every single day. Number 4. Vlad the Impaler. You know, with a title like Vlad the Impaler, it's safe to assume that the guy was probably up to no good, demon or no demon. Perhaps you've heard the legend that Vlad Tepesh was the inspiration for Count Dracula, which should tell you even more if you want to judge of this guy's moral character. Vlad was a prince of Wallachia, an area that's now known as modern Romania. Vlad grew up in a very dark period of Wallachian history, coming up while the Ottoman Empire was setting its sights on just about everything good in Eastern Europe. Vlad was made king of Wallachia, but first he was deposed and exiled after an assassination plot on his brother and father. He would reclaim the throne in 1458 and quickly began a campaign of bloodlust to show the world he was not someone you should be messing with. One of his most infamous acts, and where the dubious title comes from, was after fending off an Ottoman invasion, he impaled 20,000 soldiers and left them as a grim forest of the damned. And some legends say he would eat dinner in front of this. Downright demonic behavior. There's some debate as to whether or not he really is the inspiration for Dracula, although of note is that beside his infamous sobriquet Vlad the Impaler, he went by the nickname Vlad Dracul, owning from his father's position in the Order of the Dragon, which translated to Dracul. There are also stories of Vlad washing his hands with the blood of his enemies, which I'm gonna be honest, that kinda sounds like something Dracula would do. It's worth noting too, no one really knows what happened to Vlad's body. We know that he was slain in battle, and that he was eventually put down after years of carnage, but his body or grave has never been found. Perhaps it's because it's still walking, or flapping, whatever a bat does.
Number 3. Herbert Mullen. 1970s again. At the exact same time, in the same area, police had 2 serial killers to keep up with. Herbert Mullen and Edmund Kemper. No relationship to each other or each other's cases. Mullen was a paranoid schizophrenic in and out of mental health facilities in California during his teens. Mullen then kills 14 people during a 4-month period due to, quote, the impending natural disaster that would happen if he didn't. Mullen was convinced that the voice in his head he was hearing was telepathic. Mullen claims the voice of the Father had explained that the Vietnam War acted as a giant sacrifice that saved us from an earthquake and another one was coming soon. Constantly hearing the man's voice named the Father, encouraging him to gain more blood sacrifices, Mullen bludgeoned a man to death with a baseball bat. Mullen claims that the man was actually Jonah from the Bible and was begging him to sacrifice himself to Mullen. He then murdered a woman in the front seat of his car before dismembering her in a nearby park. Yeah, this is real satanic stuff, I told you. His third victim, a priest that he was confessing to in a Catholic church. Mullen says the priest claims to have telepathically begged him to sacrifice his life for the cause. Mullen then killed 5 people in 1 day. He claims that all the victims telepathically begged to be sacrificed as a good deed to the Father. Herbert Mullen remains in custody. And who was the Father who kept talking to him through all of these people? Number 2, Richard Ramirez. This next guy is really nasty and deserves to be in the second spot. 13 counts of murder, 5 attempted murders, 11 assault, and 14 burglaries. Sounds like a hell of a guy. The Night Stalker. Charming name for what this man did. Born in Texas, his older brother went to Vietnam and returned with some pretty gruesome stories and some pretty gruesome visuals. The young Ramirez, soaking all of this up, grows up obsessed with the satanic occult and fascinated. He made various references to Satan during his legal proceedings. His trial began in 1989, and he was convicted of 13 murders and a variety of other crimes. Nearly 2 months later, he was sentenced to death, with the judge stating that his crimes showed, quote, cruelty, callousness, and viciousness beyond any human understanding. And the worst part was that he made most of his victims pray to Satan and swear on Satan that they were gonna tell him the truth, whatever he asked. I'm not really gonna get into the sick details of really what this man did, nor will I with the number one spot, but it involved hammers, machetes, ropes, knives, guns, you name it, anything violent. He was an absolute nasty creature that liked to torture his victims and really drive the satanic love for you know who. First responders would have taken pictures of numerous satanic symbols drawn on the walls in almost a ritualistic reenactment. He was captured by the use of the huge media surrounding his story on the way to take his next victim's life. His trial was truly a disgusting display of media attention, one of the most expensive court cases to date, losing only to O.J. Simpson. He screamed Hail Satan at his hearing and flashed self-harm pentagrams. He died of cancer in 2013. This guy must have signed some sort of book for you know who. Coming in at number 1, Charles Manson. Okay, so most of us are all familiar with this man and his famous case amongst American pop culture. Ramirez was said to have been a copycat of this man, and I can see why with all the satanic ness. California in the late 1960s. A criminal, musician, and a victim of LSD studies, Charles Manson would go on to start and lead the Manson family cult. A small religious group with unclear motives, but lost souls and a ton of drugs, and a father to now a family. In summer 1969, some of the cult members committed murders in LA. Apparently, Manson had ordered his followers to kill the people who had lived at the address he had given them for their initiation. The murder of actress Sharon Tate and 4 others in her home on August 8th and 9th, including the LaBiancas, the next day. Another 2 victims. 4 members of the family committed the murders under Manson's instructions and satanic offering. Manson apparently heard voices that there was going to be a race war brought on by religious disputes, and that these killings were an offering to who exactly? The famous Helter Skelter message, incoherent scribbles, blood all over the walls. They were then to hide underground in, quote, the bottomless pit under Death Valley, which Manson knew the location of, but instead were caught on the run days later. Manson was sentenced to life in prison under the pretense that he was the one who targeted, planned, and brainwashed his, quote, piggies into committing. While in prison, Charles was diagnosed with schizophrenia and paranoid delusion disorder, seeing visions and hearing voices for more than half of his life. He died in prison in 2017. Yeah, I've seen what Tarantino did with his latest movie, and it's definitely a subtle PG-13 fiction version of what actually went down on that night. What do you guys think? Do you think Charles saw the devil? I think he actually was the devil.
Number 5, the Servant Girl Annihilator. I can't believe I just said those words. The Servant Girl Annihilator. I can't believe that's the real name newspapers went with to call this guy. I know not everyone's gonna be able to get a nickname like Jack the Ripper, but you can't go around calling criminals stuff like the Servant servant girl Annihilator. You're just gonna inflate their ego. You're making him sound like he's a Dark Souls boss, or he's gonna be jumping in the ring against Hulk Hogan and the Iron Sheik. Anyway, sorry, I had to get this out of the way before we could talk about it. I feel like we just had to address this name. We couldn't just look at that and move on. And you know the wildest part? He doesn't even have the craziest name on this list. Okay, let's get into it. The servant girl Annihilator was the nickname of a brutal night stalker who preyed on the streets of Austin, Texas in 1885, a full 3 years before Jack the Ripper would stalk Whitechapel and steal all the fame and fortune in the attacking women at night community. Despite his name, he actually didn't exclusively target women. Unlike his British counterpart, Mr. the Ripper, the SVGA attacked men and women, although he mostly focused his attention on women, and they were all servant girls, which is where the name came from. He ended up slaying 7 women and 1 man, and critically injured 6 women and 2 men on top of that. All of his victims carried out the same way, attacking them whilst they slept in their beds, and then dragging them out into the streets when he was finished with them, usually with a sharp object, such as a knife or a needle sticking out of the ear. There was a wild manhunt for the Annihilator, and it's said that in 1885, some 400 men were questioned and interrogated about the identity of the Annihilator. Elected officials apparently refused to believe that it could be the work of one lone psycho, thinking there was a group of men committing these crimes together for Lord knows why. While several men would end up being questioned, no one was ever successfully linked to these brutal crimes. He was never caught, but an increased presence by sheriff's department and citizens forming an armed militia to protect the streets were enough to scare off whoever was doing it into fleeing the area, and eventually the crime stopped. So where did he go? That's the question, because he was never found. There are some who even wonder if perhaps maybe he bought himself a train ticket and found his way to Whitechapel to continue his spree. And my friends, if you're looking for more true crime stories, more rumors, whispers, conspiracies, cryptids, aliens, video games, movies, and whatever else we got, Top 5 Scary has it all. Number 4, Bible John. Everyone on this list has a weird nickname. Everybody. I'm gonna tell you that right now. I'm just gonna spoil that for you. Coming up next on this list is going to be Bible John, who's got a name that is deceptively unassuming. Bible John was an infamous executioner who preyed on women in Glasgow in the late 60s. All of his victims he met at a popular nightclub, the Barrel and Ballroom. He operated for a few years, and is confirmed to be connected to at least 3 cases, and maybe more. He was subject to one of Scotland's most extensive manhunts. He was the first time a composite sketch in the country was ever used as the front page of the newspaper. All because there were so few details about the case, or just who he was. What few tidbits of trivia and information we have on Bible John, his crimes, his motives, and his modus operandi come from one of the victim's sisters, who very briefly shared a taxi with Bible John and her sister on the night of her death. Her very brief witness, it was only a 20-minute trip, was all the information they had to provide investigators to form a psychological profile of him, aiding in the investigation. Now, the name Bible John would stem from his practice of obsessively quoting the Bible and ranting and raving about adultery to his victims before, well, you know. The statement we have with Gene Puttock states that in the short period of time they spent together, he was making nigh constant and frequent references to specific Bible passages and really hammering home how much he hated adulterous women. He preyed on brunette women who all looked fairly similar and found them all at the same nightclub, charming them and then attacking them. Their bodies would later be found naked in the streets with signs of strangulation. The only witness, one Gene Puttock, passed away in 2010, with no more leads and the case having been on ice for nearly 50 years. It's very unlikely Bible John will ever be found anytime soon if he's still out there. Number 3, Jack the Ripper. Jack the Ripper is one of history's most infamous criminals, and honestly, maybe the most. Over 130 years ago, and we are still absolutely fascinated by his crimes, and we still don't even know for certain who he was. Could still be out there, he could still be at large. He terrorized Whitechapel through the year of 1888, leaving behind a series of sickeningly grisly crime scenes, torn apart and left in the street for all to see. There are at least 5 confirmed cases that are attributed to Jack the Ripper, but there are several more that are speculated to be attached to him, with some suggesting that it could be anywhere from 13 or higher. Jack eluded capture, stupefied his pursuers, and taunted his would-be captors, sending the police souvenirs, I guess, from his crimes, wrapping in the mail and sending them out. On one occasion, he did this alongside a threatening letter, boldly claiming to be from hell, known as the From Hell Letter. The jeering letter taunted the police, inviting them to catch him, while he described the pleasure he took in his sick, sordid dealings. Investigators were downright stumped trying to find the guy. They suspected he didn't have any level of medical training, as his hurried slashes led them to believe he could have been a butcher. The way he slashed his victims was beyond horrific. He left them missing and in some cases beyond recognition. It seemed too like he could be in multiple places at once. A body discovered in New York a few years after the crime spree matched the victims of Whitechapel almost perfectly. Was it a human performing all these sickening acts? Or could the Ripper's mangling be attributed to a demon that was preying on the women of White Castle? It would explain how he was so elusive and managed to evade capture for all those years. Number 2. Emperor Nero. Now, perhaps you've heard of Emperor Nero. You've probably heard the story of him playing the fiddle as Rome burned around him. But honestly, historically, that barely even cracks the top 5 craziest things Nero ever accomplished in his tenure as emperor. Nero set a new standard for wildness as a world leader that I think has never been matched again. Where do I begin with him? Let's start off small. He had a dedicated legion of soldiers, referred to as the Augustans, whose sole function was to follow him around and clap and hype him up whenever he would perform. Now that's kind of harmlessly crazy. So what about the story that Nero used to use his enemies as torches for his gardens? Yeah, Nero had a passionate hatred for Christians, blaming them for the infamous fire that engulfed Rome, which some historians believe Nero himself started. That's pretty wild. But what about the fact that Nero would dress himself in the skins of animals with his romantic partners? Or about how he orchestrated the deaths of his mother and brother? Nero ensured his own position as Emperor of Rome. Emperor Claudius married Nero's mother Agrippina, who then adopted Nero as his own son. When Agrippina poisoned Claudius, Nero took the throne, and then to ensure that he could keep that position on that lofty chair, he poisoned his stepbrother and would later poison his own mother to make sure no one could challenge him as emperor. He then enjoyed all the pleasures of Rome as much as he could. He depleted the treasury of Rome at one point solely to make a statue of himself in his own honor, the Colossus of Nero, to leave a lasting legacy. In the end, after years of insanity, Nero took his own life by ordering one of his own servants to stab him, after being told he would be executed by the state as he was considered an enemy of Rome. He bemoaned what an artist the world was losing. Nero's proclivity for wild debauchery, outrageous pursuits of pleasure, intense wanton cruelty, and violence towards Christians led some people at the time to view Nero as the Antichrist himself. And to be honest, I get it. Number 1. Manson. Charles Manson. The most infamous cult leader in history. And he might very well be one of the most famous criminals of all time. Charles Manson had a hypnotic level of control over his devout followers, leading them to a dark crime spree that would claim the lives of 35 people. Now, Manson himself never raised a blade to anyone that we know of, but rather used his domineering charisma to orchestrate the slayings down to the littlest details. He had a grim vision of an apocalypse where he believed there was going to be a race war, and that his family needed to prepare for this. And part of these preparations was bumping off key celebrities he had a list of. Manson had dominion over his followers, giving them sacrament every day, when in reality he was just giving them illegal substances to keep them impressionable. He banned glasses, calendars, watches, clocks, and anything that would ground them to the real world and made them more malleable to his will. Now, Manson and his family are host to a number of conspiracy theories. There's a very popular one saying that Manson himself is a product of the CIA's MKUltra brainwashing program, and this is why he was so effective at controlling other people, and that the whole Manson family cult was a CIA op to destabilize the hippie movement. But another very prevailing theory is that the Manson family were Satanists, and they were part of a nationwide cabal connected with other dark crimes around the same time, like the Son of Sam. Manson's obsession with evil, his dark dealings, and complete control over his subjects do make him seem a bit like a modern-day Lucifer. Could Manson have had a supernatural level of control over people? Number 5. Niccolo Paganini. The first up on our list today of people who summoned the devil or a demon of some kind is Niccolo Paganini, who was once called the devil's violinist, which is quite the nickname. Looks great on a resume. I didn't know the devil really hired help like that. Paganini, which does sound a bit like a delicious sandwich, was born in 1782. In Genoa, Italy. Under his father's influence, he was given lessons by renowned violinists, quickly becoming a prodigy. His musical talents were praised, and he was given all manner of scholarships. He had his first performance at 11, and by age 15, he was already touring around Italy performing. Just in case you needed something to compare yourself to and feel bad about your own achievements. Don't feel bad. I'm 26. I haven't toured Italy once. He was particularly well known for being able to perform recitals without sheet music. He memorized everything and was apparently able to play 12 notes a second at an inhuman speed. Now, while this could be explained by the fact that he'd been raised to play the violin in a Spartan-like upbringing, locals around Genoa began to whisper and tell stories of how he must have sold his soul to be able to play the violin like that. It also didn't help much that Niccolo's pale, lanky, and quite ghost-like appearance made people a bit suspicious of the guy. I get it. As someone who's very tall, lanky, and ghost-like, people ask me all the time, Taylor, did you sell your soul to be so good at YouTube hosting? The answer? Yes. Paganini was a striking man with hollow cheeks, pale skin, and very long, thin fingers, which did not calm any of these rumors down. These things plagued his reputation, with people claiming outlandish things, saying they'd seen him with hooves, they'd seen him talking to the devil. Some say his violin was made out of the intestines of a woman he'd slain, and her soul was trapped in his violin, which I guess would make it sound beautiful? Now, in the end, Paganini would contract tuberculosis, and found himself getting weaker and weaker as the months and years went by. Before his death, he turned away last rites from a Catholic priest, saying he didn't need them because he wasn't going to die. He would pass shortly after. Was it because he'd already made his last rites with Satan, or was he just confident? It's up to you to decide. And if you're looking for more freaky stories of demonic possession, exorcisms, and all that jazz, we've got loads of that on the channel. If ghosts and goblins ain't your jam, we've got cryptids, conspiracies, aliens, government cover-ups, basically anything scary above or under the sun, we've covered it more than a few times. So click on through, hit that bell to not miss a single scream, but please, do that at the end of this video, okay? We got way more scary stories coming up for you. Number 4, Latoya Ammons. Our next entry on this list is Latoya Ammons and her mother, Rosa Campbell, involving an infamous haunting that is sometimes referred to as the 200 Demon House or the Demon House. That's a lot of demons. A family moved into a new house in Gary, Indiana, only to quickly discover that the house already had plenty of residents. They claimed that black flies would swarm the porch every single day in December in a climate that should reasonably have had them die off. Mother Rosa Campbell claims she heard footsteps in the basement and doors creaking, and witnessed a shadowy specter of a man pacing around her living room, claiming he was leaving behind boot prints. Now that's pretty scary. But the most wild claim was that this spirit man once choked her directly. Rosa's daughter Latoya claimed that she levitated above her daughter while unconscious during a sleepover, leading to her friend praying for her safety until she returned to the ground. Another wild incident describes an unknown force pushing the son of the family firmly into a wall, with a voice in the back of his head screaming, "It's time to die." Strangely, the family didn't decide to, you know, burn the house down and move out and change state lines, but instead reached out to their family physician. You know the old saying, when there's something strange, who are you gonna call? Your local general practitioner. Well, the doc visited the house and noted that he thought the behavior of the family was delusional. So the family went to Father Michael Maganote in 2012, who was called in to perform an exorcism. He believed the family had unintentionally summoned a demon and were being tormented by hundreds of demons. The real estate agent didn't mention that, did he? In the end, the father exorcised the house and the Ammons family moved to Indianapolis in peace, where they now await a movie deal from 20th Century Fox, I'm certain. Number 3, the Doodler. Next up on this list is the Doodler. Like everybody else, don't let the goofy name fool you into thinking there is anything silly or funny about this guy. Now, this bizarre nickname would come about from his habit of drawing pictures of his victims before he would attack them. And I guess the drawer or the sketcher or the artist didn't quite roll off the tongue the same way that the Doodler did, and that's the name they went with. The exact body count of the Doodler is unknown, but police believe that it could be anywhere from 6 to 14 victims total in San Francisco, stretching from 1974 to 1975. Several men disappeared from the city's gay community, and more were injured. And part of what made him so hard to identify is that despite the city's historically very liberal and accepting view of the LGBTQ+ community, at the time, the larger mainstream whole community hadn't quite got there yet. And so, several of the men who would end up surviving an attack were too worried about outing themselves to want to cooperate with the police, leading to very few victims cooperating with the police. Meaning there was very little information for any of them to work with, and the criminal was able to successfully elude pursuit. Ironically, for someone named a Doodler, the composite face sketch they had from witnesses is the only real bit of evidence they ever had to work with. However, unlike a lot of the other cases on this list, this one is actually still actively ongoing. There's a $200,000 reward for anyone that has any additional information. And as of 2019, this case is still ongoing, with DNA and fingerprints fingerprint evidence being used to try to narrow down the ever-wide net of potential subjects of interest and hopefully get some closure on a horrible chapter in San Francisco's history. Number 2, the Pickler. Now, I've talked about the Pickler before on this channel, but his story is so horrifying and honestly unbelievable that it's worth repeating at least once. Again, goes without saying, like every single entry else on this list, the Pickler leads you to believe this is going to be a silly story, but wait about a minute, I'll explain why he's called the Pickler and all the pieces will come together and you'll regret clicking on this video. This one's kind of a dark one. The Pickler's real name was Bella Kiss, and he worked as a tinsmith in the early 1900s, living in a humble small village in Hungary. He had been married and he had children, but his wife had left and with her took the children. He moved in a housekeeper who served as his sole faithful companion. His housekeeper would note that he seemed to entertain a plethora of female guests and was never hurting for women's attention, although she didn't talk to any of the guests much. Outside of his women callers, Kiss was actually fairly isolated. He kept to himself mostly. He didn't interact with his neighbors much at all or the community as a whole, instead preferring to tend to himself and living quietly alone with his housekeeper and his big collection of metal drums. He had a stockpile of metal drums all over his property, and when people would ask about them, he said that he was stockpiling gas. In 1914, Kiss would be conscripted to serve with the Hungarian army and left behind his home to his noble housekeeper. While deployed, Hungarian soldiers were running low on resources, and when they needed gas, some soldiers on patrol saw fit to take from Kiss's collection over his property. However, when they went to recover the gas, they were shocked to discover what the barrels actually contained. No gas to be found, but instead the bodies of several missing women floating in alcohol in an attempt to preserve or pickle their corpses. Eh? See what I mean? Not pleasant even remotely. There were 20 barrels in total, and inside each one was another missing woman. But perhaps most alarmingly of all of this is that they appeared to have been drained of their bodily fluids with punctures in the neck, which sounds made up. As if this guy wasn't scary enough, there's also the very real possibility that he might have been a vampire. Now, upon this discovery, the Hungarian army immediately moved to try and locate and apprehend Bella Kiss, but discovered that that would prove quite difficult, since he had both a very common Hungarian name at the time, and he was also deployed in the middle of the largest conflict the world had ever seen at the time, and was just one more face in a green uniform. Somehow, Kiss learned that he was being pursued and faked his death by leaving behind a corpse in a hospital that had his ID. Kiss fled and was never seen in Europe again. A few scattered sightings would report him throughout New York, but he was never found and eluded capture for the remainder of his days. It's unlikely he's still out there, but you never know. And finally, number 1, the Zodiac. If we're talking about evil people who've managed to elude capture, it might feel a little obvious to put the Zodiac as number 1, you know? But he's also one of the most infamous, strangest, and scariest criminal stories in American history, so it's never a bad story. Well, it is. It's a terrible story, but it's a very interesting one to hear. The Zodiac terrorized California throughout the late 60s and early 70s, personally claiming responsibility for 37 victims. He stole headlines and media attention for years, as the state was fascinated and terrified by what he would do next, and if he would ever be caught. His exploits have been the subject of a few films and TV, most famously David Fincher's Zodiac, starring Jake Gyllenhaal and Robert Downey Jr., dramatizing the investigation trying to find him unsuccessfully. Although he himself insisted that he left a trail of 37 bodies, the police were only ever able to connect 5 different deaths to the Zodiac. People would be attacked by a lone gunman, with nothing seemingly connecting the cases. Motive, modus, everything was unclear. The case would become legendary when he sent his infamous letters to 3 separate newspapers, containing details that only the real assailant could have possibly known about the crimes, inviting and challenging police to a game to catch him. He sent out a postcard boldly displaying, "My name is," and then a blank spot, with an invitation to solve one of his puzzles. If you saw the new 2022 Batman movie, Paul Dano's Riddler is directly inspired off the Zodiac, all of his methodology, taunting people, leaving weird riddles at his crime scenes, that sort of stuff. His letters were threatening, taunting, and incomprehensible. The code he wrote in would stump detectives for years, to this day, with only one of his ciphers ever being solved, and it not being nearly enough to connect any dots. The riddle that was solved spelled out a confession of sorts, but it mostly served as the Zodiac gloating about the nature of his crimes, and saying that he did it solely because he thought it was fun, and that it was the most thrilling, fun thing a man could do, described as being better than hunting games or getting your rocks off. He didn't mention whether or not it was better than writing riddles and codes, though. Now, at the time, obviously they looked into just about everyone they could, and there were several prominent suspects and people of interest, but nothing concrete and final. The rest of his riddles were never solved, and as far as we know, he was was never caught. However, in 2018, a private team of investigators was absolutely determined to close the case once and for all and put an end to one of California's most infamous mysteries. They had identified an 80-year-old Gary Francis Post who had passed away. He resembled the composite sketches of the Zodiac, and forensic evidence had actually made some compelling arguments that could tie it to being him, but the FBI have denied this claim and say that they still consider the case open. Will it ever be closed within our lifetime? We may never know, but the one thing that's certain is that we are not going to stop trying until we get some answers. You want my theory? Personally, I think Jack the Ripper is the Zodiac. I think that would be the ultimate plot twist to the end of all of this.
Number 5, Joseph Mengele. I'm just gonna get this out of the way now. This man is the only entry from the Second World War on today's list. And that's mainly because, well, like I said before, online guidelines make it practically impossible for me to talk about the evil German dictator or members of his party. Also known as the Angel of Death, Dr. Mengele was an anthropologist and SS physician who conducted numerous inhumane medical experiments on the prisoners in Auschwitz. He was born on March 16th, 1911 in the Bavarian city of places I cannot pronounce Germany, and was the eldest son of Karl Mengele, a manufacturer of farming equipment. Joseph studied medicine and physical anthropology at several universities. In 1935, he earned a PhD in physical anthropology from the University of Munich, and in 1936, he passed the state medical exams. In 1937, he began working at the Institute for Hereditary Biology and Racial Hygiene in Frankfurt, you know, Germany. There, he was an assistant to the director, Dr. Otmar von Verschuer, a leading geneticist known for his research on twins. So under that doctor's direction, Joseph completed an additional doctorate in 1938. He was particularly interested in twins, as twin research was seen at the time to be the ideal way to determine how the environment or human heredity influenced the human body. At Auschwitz, he was one of a number of medical professionals who selected victims to be sentenced to the gas chambers, or to be spared for his experimental research. He would attempt red fluid transfusions from one twin to the other, do amputations and try and sew it onto the other twin, stitch two twins together to form Siamese twins, infect one twin with typhus or another disease, and way too many other experiments. To the surprise of no one, more often than not, the twins died during the procedures, or he would have them killed afterwards just so he could do an autopsy for funsies. If one twin died from a disease, he would often kill the other as well to mark the differences between the sick and healthy subjects. The evil doctor was also very interested in heterochromia, where people have irises of different colors, and he would collect eyes and body parts of his victims and send it through for research. He would inject chemicals in victims' eyes to attempt to change their eye color. Nowadays, you know, we just use contacts. I have a whole collection. He also experimented on pregnant women before sending them off to the gas chambers and caused incestuous pregnancies, always under the guise of research. He tried sex change operations, removing organs, and operating on victims without anesthesia. And if all that wasn't wild enough, he tried to prove that Jewish and Romani people were genetically inferior through his morbid experimentation. Throughout his time at Auschwitz, Joseph sent his colleagues in Germany red fluids, body parts, organs, skeletons, and fetuses that had been taken from prisoners. He managed to escape imprisonment after war, first by working as a farm stableman in Bavaria, then by moving to South America. He later moved to Brazil, where he met up with another former Yahtzee party member, Wolfgang Gerhard. In 1985, a multinational team of forensic experts traveled to Brazil in search of Joseph. They determined that a man named Gerhard had died of a stroke while swimming in 1979, and dental records later revealed that Joseph had, at some point, assumed Wolfgang's identity and was the stroke victim. Number 4, Paul Bernardo. Okay, I'm cheating a little bit on this one, since I'll be covering both Paul Bernardo and Carla Homolka. If you don't believe that she's just as twisted, if not more so than he is, wait till the end of this and see if I can't change your mind, because my stomach is already turning. If a lawyer is willing to be disbarred by revealing what was told to him in confidence, that's pretty telling in my book. So Paul Kenneth Bernardo is a Canadian serial killer and more, who was dubbed the Skullgirl Killer and other monikers I can't say thanks to the interwebs hating the R word, and together with his former wife, Carla Homolka, one half of the Ken and Barbie Killers. So Paul was born in Scarborough, Ontario on August 27th of 1964, the third and youngest of Kenneth Walter Bernardo and Marilyn Elizabeth Bernardo. So Kenneth Sr. often sexually took advantage of Paul's older sister Deborah in front of other family members, and would eventually be charged with crimes involving voyeurism and P-word crimes. If you need elaboration on any of the words I can't say today, I assure you someone in the comments can help. Marilyn Bernardo often withdrew from her family due to depression and agoraphobia, eventually moving into the basement. Paul presented himself being, you know, a happy and well-adjusted youth, despite his family's dysfunction, and was an active member of the Boy Scouts. Beneath the charming facade, however, he gradually developed pyromaniac inclinations and dark sexual fantasies, one of which involved creating a virgin farm where he would breed virgins to take advantage of sexually. And here I thought I dodged a bullet when it came to my ex that had people-munching fantasies and was way too into My Little Pony. Later in life, Paul was diagnosed with sexual sadism, voyeurism, narcissistic personality disorder, and met the requirement for a diagnosis of psychopathy. So, you know, that checks. After a fight between his parents when he was in high school, Paul was informed by his mother that he was the result of an extramarital affair and that Kenneth was not his biological father. Repulsed by all of this, Paul began to call his mother a salute, and she reciprocated by calling him a bastard from hell. Later, after growing weary of Bernardo's domineering behavior, his first girlfriend left him for one of his friends, and in retaliation, he set fire to all of her belongings that he could find. Between 1987 and 1990, Bernardo committed increasingly vicious sexual crimes in and around Scarborough, attacking most of his victims after stalking them as they got off buses late in the evening. Oh yeah, I totally feel safe right now. From May to September of 1990, Toronto police submitted more than 130 suspect samples for DNA testing and received two tips pointing to Bernardo. So they interviewed him on November 20th for 35 minutes, and he voluntarily provided DNA samples for testing, but was not arrested at this time for any of those crimes. During this time frame, he met and got engaged to Carla Homolka, and that's when things escalated from sexual crimes to killings. While there are three notable killings, I'm just gonna talk about the one that disturbs me the most for time purposes. So although he was engaged to Carla, Paul had become obsessed with her younger sister Tammy, peering into her window and entering her room to get himself off while she slept. Carla helped Bernardo by breaking the windows in her sister's room, allowing him access. According to Paul's testimony at trial, Carla laced spaghetti sauce with crushed Valium she had stolen from her employer at an animal clinic. She served it to her sister, who soon lost consciousness, and Bernardo then did icky things to Tammy while Carla watched. After a minute, Tammy regained consciousness, and it only gets worse from here. 6 months before their 1991 wedding, Carla stole the sleeping pills from the clinic, and on December 23rd of 1990, Carla and Paul administered said pills to Tammy in a rum and eggnog cocktail. When Tammy lost consciousness, Carla and Paul undressed her, and Carla applied a halothane-soaked cloth to her sister's nose and mouth. Carla wanted to give Tammy's virginity to Paul for Christmas, since according to her, Paul was disappointed that he was not Carla's first sexual partner, and the duo also had a video camera on hand for the experience. You can't make stuff like this up. Tammy began to vomit, they tried to revive her and called 911 after hiding evidence, dressing Tammy and moving her into her bedroom, but she never woke up. Despite being observed vacuuming and washing laundry in the middle of the night and, you know, evidence of a chemical burn on Tammy's face, the regional municipality of Niagara Coroner and Carla's family accepted the couple's version of events, that Tammy had just choked on her vomit after consumption of alcohol. After Tammy's death, Paul and Carla videotaped themselves engaging in sexual intercourse, with Carla wearing Tammy's clothing and pretending to be her. Thankfully, now Paul is in jail for the rest of his life, but Carla is out in public, living alone in Salaberry de Valleyfield.
Number 3, Robert Johnson. Robert Johnson could play the blues. Real well. In fact, he played it so darn well that people suspected he wasn't just really in tune with the music, but had made a deal with the devil to pluck the strings. Johnson was born in Mississippi in May 1911 and lived alongside his 9 siblings. Good gosh, imagine the rush for the bathroom in the mornings. He eventually made his way to Memphis, where he discovered his love for the blues, and boy howdy could he play them. By all accounts, he was a legendary harmonica player, but initially, his friends would describe him as a pretty lousy guitarist. Well, practice makes perfect, right? Well, practice and demonic transaction. Because the story goes that Johnson would disappear for a few weeks entirely and buried his guitar at the crossroads of the now famous Highways 49 and 61 in Clarksdale, Mississippi, where the devil retuned his instrument and blessed his hands with the unnatural skills that made him a legend. When he started playing again, he was an overnight master of the blues. Now, unfortunately, the blues is born out of tragedy, and Robert Johnson was sadly no different. He passed away at the fairly early age of 27, the infamous age in which rock stars and famous musicians are purported to die with an alarming regularity. Amy Winehouse, Kurt Cobain, to rattle off a few. What makes this particular death odd, though, is how few details exist. His death was never reported, no autopsy ever performed, no cause ever given. The only thing we have to go on is local folklore. One in particular tells the story of Johnson playing at a country dance, where Johnson had been flirting with a married woman, and she gave Johnson a bottle of whiskey, which was slapped out of his hands by Sonny Boy Williamson, another musician at the exact same show. And he told him not to drink anything that he hadn't personally seen the lid come off of, which is fairly good advice. And Johnson responded by saying, "Don't ever knock a drink out of my hand." Johnson would die in a convulsive state 3 days later, with some believing that he'd been poisoned by the woman and her husband as revenge. Or perhaps it was just the devil coming back for the merchandise that he paid for, his soul. Number 2, Agrippa. Heinrich Cornelius Agrippa was a scholar living in the 15th century with one of the coolest names ever. Corny Agrippa. Agrippa devoted his life to writing about the occult. Now, I can freely talk to you about the occult, the devil, and all manner of blasphemous heretical things, but things haven't always been so liberal. And way back when, even so much of breathing about the devil was tantamount to sinning, so Agrippa was not a man without controversy. He wrote of the devil in great, intricate detail. His books would include information breaking down exactly how witches cast spells and perform incantations and rituals, and even shared where they get all of their cool outfits, big hats, and big stomping boots. It's mostly Hot Topic and doll skill. So where did Agrippa get all of this information? Was he just making it up? Was he really in tune with the local scene? Kind of. He claimed that when he was a young man, he gave in to the temptation of Satan and ran with a convent of witches going around engaging in rituals and casting spells, and I gotta be honest, that sounds awesome. I did a similar thing when I followed Grimes on tour. Eventually, Agrippa is said to have cleaned up a little, got over his goth phase, and said to have found Jesus and saved his soul, and began to write books preaching the good word about how you should let Jesus in your life and push the devil on out of here. Surprisingly, Agrippa was never executed despite his open nature regarding his witchcraft and occult days. It's a common misconception that he was executed for his heresy, but actually, in the end, Agrippa pushed people for be more understanding of demons and the devil and pushed for people to know their enemy. He wanted to save people from the devil's grasp and save them through prayer rather than just burning them all at the stake, which is a noble goal. And number one, Anna Eklund. Perhaps you've heard the story of Anna Eklund before. We've covered it on the channel, I think, and it was made into a popular movie, appropriately enough, titled The Exorcism of Anna Eklund, so you don't confuse it with any other exorcism movies out there. Now, Anna's story is infamous. She's a young woman from America who has the dubious award of having the world's longest exorcism, spanning decades of exorcising. Those demons were in there good. Those are demons with, like, rent control. You're not getting them out of that apartment. It would begin in 1912, when Eklund underwent an exorcism by Father Theophilus Reisinger, a Bavarian priest. It seemed like things were successful and Anna was freed, but then in 1928, Anna began exhibiting all the telltale signs of demonic possession yet again, and Reisinger returned to perform a second exorcism on Eklund. Eklund was taken into a convent on August 1928 to be dealt with round the clock. She would behave oddly, to say the least, hissing at them like a cat, flying into fits of violent rage when offered food that had been doused in holy water. This exorcism was brutal even by exorcism standards, with Eklund allegedly levitating, howling, hanging out the door frame. Eklund was believed to be possessed by not just any old rank and file demon, but allegedly was possessed by Judas Iscariot, big celebrity demon inside, alongside the ghost of her own father. Alongside the ghost of her own father, who had an affair with her aunt and had made unwanted advances to Anna in life. After months of exorcising, and not the good kind, Anna's body deteriorated. She would vomit up debris, her head and face swelled, she refused to consume food or drink. Eventually, after months and years of exorcism, on December 23rd, the final day of the exorcism, the battle was won and Anna was freed, and by all accounts went on to live a fairly normal life afterwards. A Christmas miracle if there ever was one.
Number five on this list is Edward Edwards. Edward Edwards, for those who don't know, was an American serial killer who did most of his killing from 1977 to 1996. He has 5 confirmed kills to his name, however, he's suspected of several additional murders that were never solved. Edward always had an affinity to crime. In 1955, he actually escaped from jail and went around America robbing gas stations and was at large for 7 years. He became so well known that he actually earned a spot on the FBI's top 10 most wanted list at the time. He also refused to disguise himself during these robberies because he claimed that he wanted to become famous. Eventually, in 1962, he was found and brought in. He was sent to jail, but didn't actually spend too long there considering what he had already done. He was out on parole in 1967, which, as we'll later learn, was a horrible idea. The first known murders that Edward committed were in 1977 when he killed William Lavico and his girlfriend Judith Straub. They were both very young and he took them out into the woods and shot them both with a shotgun. 3 years after this incident, he murdered 2 people again. This time time, the victims were named Tim Hack and Kelly Drew, and instead of being shot, they were stabbed and strangled. Then in 1996 was his last confirmed murder, that of Danny Law Glockner. This was actually Edward's foster son, and he admitted to killing him for the life insurance policy of $250,000. In an interview, Edward very matter-of-factly owns up to killing Danny and shows zero remorse at all. He goes on to say that he was a schemer, and he'd always been a schemer, and was looking for a way to earn a quick buck. He said that he had planned this thing for over a year and had been preparing everything for that long. In the interview, he very carefully lays out everything that happened and does it in a manner that it seems as if he's almost boasting about it. He even talks about how he took his head and threw it into a forest a year later after animals had bitten it off, and he doesn't even blink. Edward Edwards was an extremely sick and twisted man who clearly was not capable of feeling any normal and healthy human emotions. He died in prison back in 2011. Number 4 on this list is Tommy Lynn Sells. Tommy Lynn Sells is right up there as being one of the worst serial killers of all time. The acts that he committed were so gruesome and just plain evil that I can't even begin to understand the level of inhumanity that it would have taken to do it. He was only convicted for one murder, which he received the death penalty for, but authorities believe that he committed upwards of 22. Tommy Lynn Sells was known for murdering mothers and their... He didn't just stop with them though, also killing the fathers from time to time, but there was definitely a bit of a pattern involved with the mothers. In an interview that he had while he was still alive, he comes up with a sick and twisted reason as to why he did this.
I know what I went through as a child. The nightmares, the drama, the reality of who I was and what was done to me. I never wanted that to happen to another person.
Tommy Lynn Sells argues that he killed children to put them out of their misery.
I don't even know if there are adjectives in the English language to describe how messed up that is. Tommy Lynn Sells was eventually executed on April 3rd, 2014.
Number 3, Vlad the Impaler. Also known as Vlad Dracula, he was the Prince of Wallachia three times between 1448 and his death in 1476 or 77. The character of Dracula was loosely based on Vlad due to his sadistic personality and cruel acts done to the people of Wallachia, where he reigned as prince three times between 1448 to 1462 and killed about 20% of the population. Works containing the stories about Vlad's cruelty were published in Low German in the Holy Roman Empire before 1480. The stories were allegedly written in the early 1460s because they describe Vlad's campaign across the Danube in early 1462, but they do not refer to Mehmed II's invasion of Wallachia in June of the same year. So the stories about Vlad's plundering raids in Transylvania were clearly based on eyewitness accounts, because they contain accurate details including the lists of churches raided by Vlad that were destroyed and, you know, the dates of the raids. They describe Vlad as a demented psychopath, a sadist, a gruesome killer, and a masochist worse than Caligula and Nero. One tale explains that Vlad had a big copper cauldron built and he put a lid made of wood with holes in it on top. He put people in the cauldron and put their heads in the holes and fastened them there. He then filled it with water and set a fire under it and let people cry their eyes out until they were boiled to death. And then he invited frightening, terrible, unheard of punishment. He ordered that woman be impaled together with their suckling young on the same stake, stuck on their mother's breasts until they died. Then he had the woman's breasts cut off and put the little ones inside head first, thus he had them impaled together. He impaled victims through the buttocks until the stake came out of the mouth. A German pamphlet once read that he had young folks roasted, and then he fed them to their mothers. And he also cut off the breasts of women and forced their husbands to eat them. Yeah, nightmare cruelty. Number 2, Joseph Stalin. If I had a nickel for every time I've mentioned an evil Joseph today, I'd have 2 nickels, which isn't a lot, but it's weird that happened twice, right? So this man was dictator of the Soviet Union from 1922 until his death in 1953. As a young man, he was a robber and an assassin, so simply, you know, bad guy stuff. For almost 30 years, he reigned with terror and violence. His decisions led to a famine that killed millions. Stalin promoted Marxism and Leninism abroad through the Communist International and supported European anti-fascist movements during the 1930s, particularly in the Spanish Civil War. In 1939, his regime signed a non-aggression pact with Nazi Germany, enabling the Soviet invasion of Poland. Stalin's necessity for the Soviet Union's economic development has been questioned, and it has been argued that his policies from 1928 onwards may have only been a limiting factor. So Stalin's Soviet Union has been characterized as a totalitarian state, with Stalin as its authoritarian leader. Various biographers have described him as a dictator, an autocrat, or accused him of practicing Tsarism. He's also been labeled a red fascist. Heck, forget enemies, he even killed families of people who were fond of him. Under his rule, more than 1.5 million German women were sexually harmed, and all in all, he easily killed over 20 million people. He once said, "One death is a tragedy. A million deaths is simply a statistic." In the mother of all what the bleep sentences, he was nominated for a Nobel Peace Prize in 1945 and 1948. Number 1, Jim Jones. As if I was going to do a list of the worst people in the world and not include a single cult leader. In the 1950s, Indiana native Jim Jones founded the People's Temple, a group that he claimed promoted socialism and equality with religious elements of Christianity. Initially, he was, you know, not much more than a charismatic hustler who faked faith healings by having audience plants pull chicken livers out of congregants' mouths. But as the years progressed, he demanded more and more of his followers. In the early 1970s, he moved his group to California and set them up in a commune-like settlement in Redwood Valley. After he established several locations throughout the state, including its headquarters in San Francisco, the temple forged ties with many left-wing political figures and claimed to have 20,000 members, even though 3,000 to 5,000 is a little more likely. Jones eventually came to believe that nuclear war was imminent and moved his followers again to the South American country of Guyana, which he thought would be outside the potential danger zone. The group lived there for several years as the People's Temple Agricultural Project, but after former members started speaking out against the church, San Francisco Congressman Leo Ryan decided to travel to Jonestown to investigate claims of bad things. During his visit, a number of temple members expressed a desire to leave with him and accompanied Leo to the local airstrip at Port Kituma. There they were intercepted by self-styled temple security guards who opened fire on the group, killing the congressman, three journalists, and one of the defectors, as well as injuring 9 others, including Ryan's aide, Jackie Spire. A few seconds of the incident were captured on video by NBC cameraman Bob Brown, one of the journalists killed in the attack. That evening in Jonestown, Jones ordered his congregation to drink a concoction of the cyanide-laced grape-flavored Flavor-Aide. Oh yeah, so this is where the phrase drinking the Kool-Aid originates, but it was actually Flavor-Aide. All in all, 918 people died, including 276 minors. When members wept and showed signs of dissent, Jones counseled, you know, "Stop these hysterics. This is not the way for people who are socialists or communists to die. No way for us to die. We must die with some dignity." On a tape, he can be heard saying, "Don't be afraid to die," adding that death is just stepping over into another plane and a friend. So Jones directed that the youngest folks be killed first. His wife Marceline apparently protested against this. She was then forcibly restrained, but eventually joined the other adults in poisoning herself. Some members resisted ending their lives and were injected with fatal doses of cyanide, as were those too young to drink the drink, and some others survived by fleeing through the jungle. Until 9/11, it was the largest loss of American civilian life in history, which sends a chill down my spine to talk about.
Number 5. John Wayne Gacy. John Wayne Gacy is one of America's most infamous criminal cases. He's practically single-handedly responsible for traumatizing an entire generation into a fear of clowns. A vicious sadist and a remorseless criminal, hearing clips of him talk is deeply disturbing. In a series of interviews in 1992, Mr. Gacy offered a rare window into the mind of a lunatic. In the interviews, Gacy is adamant that he is innocent of his crimes and talks in a remarkably pleasant, almost affable way. He seems like an average Joe, a chatty old man that you would probably talk to at a park or something, until little cracks in the facade keep appearing and its darkness comes out. He appears to be talking himself in circles. At one point, it seems like he indirectly confesses to something he claimed that he hadn't, and when the interviewer presses him on it, he retracts like a child being caught in a lie, saying, "I'm sorry if I led you to believe that." In the same interview, the reporter asks Gacy to show him the rope trick, the horrifying method of strangulation Gacy would use on his victims by applying a tourniquet. Gacy obliges, but when the reporter hands him the string, he chuckles wryly and says, "Aren't you scared sitting next to me?" Most chilling is when the subject changes to talk of his clowning. He seems like he genuinely loved it, and knowing the unspeakable acts he committed as a clown makes it all the more sinister. He talks about how to him, clowning was an act of regression. It allowed him to explore his inner child within. Deeply, deeply unsettling. Perhaps most upsetting, though, is hearing Gacy talk about his anger towards his victim's family, saying they're overreacting. And you realize everything about the persona you've seen in the interviews is all just an act, just more makeup. My ghouls and goblins, if you're enjoying what we do on the channel and you want to hear more true crime stories, then subscribe to Top 5 Scared. We've got stuff coming every day. Number 4, The Night Stalker. Richard Ramirez terrorized Los Angeles for 14 months between 1984 and 1985. But perhaps you know him better under the sobriquet The Night Stalker. Maybe you saw the Netflix documentary that came out a bit recently. He was named that due to his propensity to seek into people's houses undetected and then carry out his sickening crimes. Eventually, he was caught after a facial sketch made newspaper front pages, leading to him being apprehended by an angry mob and arrested. He didn't see many interviews or too much direct media attention, but one that was filmed prior to his final sentencing showcases his twisted nature and the utter remorselessness of someone who was called the Night Stalker. While being asked about the nature of his crimes and the horrific dealings of them, Ramirez appears amused, smiling, almost holding back laughter. When asked outright about his motives, he smirks as if he's holding in a secret. It gets worse when he starts to wax poetic and philosophize about human nature. He chuckles a bit when asked if he thinks of himself as evil and says, "We're all evil." He insists that what he did is no different than what governments do on a large scale. He claims, saying he is merely a product of his time and that he was living in bloodthirsty times. Every word hangs in the air uncomfortably. He denies to answer if he feels emotions. He says he gave up on the feeling of love and happiness long before his crime spree started. But everything he says seems very fake and self-serving. The interviewer even notes this, saying, "You do a very good job reading off the script, Richard." There's an appearance of gloating as he talks as well. He expresses that he felt he would be crushed by his own desires if he didn't act on them. And when asked if he's afraid, he says he doesn't care what happens to him, and he never did. Truly sombering.
Number three on this list is Bernard Giles. Bernard Giles is currently serving several life imprisonments for killing five between September and November of 1973. He was only 21 years old when he committed these crimes and had a wife and a child at the time. He would get in his vehicle and drive around on highways looking for young women who needed a lift. These hitchhikers would get into his car, and before they knew what was happening, Bernard would strike. In the clip that I'm about to show you, Bernard is far older. A lot of years have passed since he's been imprisoned, but here he tries to recount his first killings.
"That day that you went out, when you did kill for the first time, was that a morning when you woke up and you were with your wife and daughter and you just, something hit you and you went,
no,
today may be the day?
Every day may be the day.
Every day?
Every day may be the day."
So there are multiple things about that clip which makes it one of the most chilling to me. I think what really gets me though is how he talks about every day being the possible day. Literally at any point, without warning, these serial killers could snap and then go on a rampage. And they don't even remember who it was that they killed. At least we know that Bernard Giles will be spending the rest of his existence locked behind bars. Number two on this list is Ted Bundy. Ted Bundy was one of the most ruthless and prolific serial killers that we've ever known. He targeted young women in the 1970s and confessed to killing over 30 of them. How many women he actually killed is unknown, but the number is thought to be significantly higher than that. He engaged in all types of sick and sadistic stuff, things that I can't get too deep into on YouTube because they were just simply that bad. A member of his own defense team even came out and said, "Ted was the very definition of heartless evil." Whenever your defense team is coming out and saying that, you know that there's no redeeming you. Bundy died back in 1989 by means of state-sanctioned electrocution. Before he was executed, though, Ted Bundy had one final interview. This interview took place in the evening of the day prior to him being executed. Watching this man who killed so many people and knowing that he's going to be executed the following day, there's just this cloud of darkness just that hangs over the whole interview. Ted Bundy described what it was like to kill someone by saying, "I want you to understand what happened. It was like coming out of some kind of horrible trance or dream. I can only liken it to being possessed by something so awful and alien, and then the next morning wake up from it, remember what happened, and realize that basically in the eyes of the law, and certainly in the eyes of God, you're responsible." Now everybody, he may sound almost remorseful in that little excerpt, but do not be fooled. This was a man who had intercourse with the dead bodies of the people he killed.
There was truly not an ounce of good in this man at all. Number one on this list is Manuel Vela. The crimes committed by Manuel Vela actually happened not too long ago, which makes this whole story that much more scary. Manuel was a 28-year-old man who only a few years ago killed his girlfriend, who was 39 weeks pregnant with his child. Like, guys, we are talking about just some of the most sick and twisted stuff ever. After he was finally apprehended, an interview took place. In that interview, he says that the only reason he was with his girlfriend all this time was to eventually kill her, and he had told her this time and time again.
Why did you stay with her?
Oh, to kill her.
So that was your only purpose this whole time?
Yes, kill her.
And you made it pretty clear to her that that was your whole purpose as well?
Yeah. Told everybody, hey, I'm gonna kill you, right? I'm telling him, kill her.
So apparently this guy had been telling her about this for years and was planning it this whole time. This is just some insane stuff that is honestly hard to break down. I have no idea how anyone could get to this place or what would cause something like this. Manuel Vela ended up taking his own life in January 2017.